Our regularly scheduled program will not be seen at this time, so that we may bring you the following special presentation.
They were groundbreaking, history-making. Marilyn Turner and John Kelly, America's first husband and wife talk show team. Together, they were Kelly and Company, Detroit's top-rated Emmy Award-winning daytime talk show. For 17 years, they paved the way for all other talk shows yet to come. We're celebrating 60 years of WXYZ Channel 7 with the best of Kelly and Company. Now, here are your hosts, Marilyn Turner and John Kelly.
You know, it's great to be back here on Channel 7 and take a look back at some of our favorite moments on Kelly and Company.
Every morning for 17 years.
Yeah, I know, a long time.
You welcomed us into your living room and made us one of Channel 7's highest rated shows ever. Every day, people wrapped around the building just wanted to be part of our studio audience.
It was a great time. And for those of you who don't know, our love story together actually began a few years before Kelly and Company. Here's a look back. John and I first met here at WXYZ working on the evening news. John co-anchored the news with Bill Bonds and I did the weather report. Didn't take long for sparks to fly, and John and I were married in 1974. 2 years later, Channel 7 came up with the idea of both of us hosting a live talk show together. The show ran from 1977 to 1995, and it was a huge hit. Over the years, we interviewed some of Hollywood's hottest stars and top newsmakers. We tackled tough issues and talked about everything from relationships to fashion, foods, fads, and finances. It was an absolute blast, and it was an honor to be part of Detroit television history. You know, I think for the most part, our off-camera relationship just added to the chemistry of the show.
Yeah, we got along most of the time.
well.
Actually, you know, it's really amazing when you think back about us and the variety of guests we had. All the topics we covered. When you tuned in at 9 every weekday morning, you really never knew what you might see.
You know, I'm looking at you right now, and you look like Phil Donahue, right? He looks like Phil Donahue. You came in here about 40 minutes ago, and I know you had a pig cap on, carrying a bunch of newspapers, and nobody knew you. You had to say, hey, I'm Phil. I'm Phil.
I know, it's very good. I started whistling my theme song.
Nobody...
Finally, one of the audience members was in the hallway. She said, hey, Merv!
Isn't it funny? People do get mixed up for one another, don't they?
Sure.
On this talk show. But do you see yourself as dark suit, dark jacket, tie, shirt, rather than casual?
Well, Marla would like to send me back. And
redo
clothes.
You?
Yeah. I was a reporter when this all happened to me, and I probably had, in 1967, I'm sure I didn't have four suits. I probably had about three suits and maybe a sport jacket. And as the show began to build, and the audience would say to me, where do you get your clothes? You know, I had a shiny gabardine suit in the blue trousers, and finally Ola Cassini came in and he said, you look terrible. And I said, well, why don't you dress me? And he did, but it was back in the time when we had men look like barber poles. You know, you had a striped tie and a striped shirt, and I never knew what went with. So I had a code, you know, the number three suit went with the B shirt and the
B4
tie. Yeah, I didn't know what I was doing. I wasn't comfortable, so I said, I'll just...
stay in.
Yeah, I've never been a clothes horse. I don't have any problem with people who are. It's just never been a
thing. You kind of like to slop around in old clothes?
Well, I'm always in blue jeans when I'm not working.
Now, you said Marlo would like to redo you.
Well, I think Marlo is... Marlo has an elegance that I admire very much. It's helped me a little bit. I mean, it doesn't always show. But this is a very, very appreciative woman of... when she sees a man with a hanky that works, you know, she likes that.
I'm always telling John, why don't you dress a little more casual? That's why I that's interesting that you said Marla would like to change something, because I'm always wanting to change him, because he believes the talk show host should wear ties and shirts and jackets and...
That's beautiful.
I don't know. I'd like...
Well, I have probably six suits now, maybe seven.
That's success. That's
success. And they're all, and most of them are either blue or gray, so I'm an early Undertaker in my clothing.
How does Marlo feel about a lot of women in this country are in love with you? They think of you as the surrogate husband. How does she feel about that? Does she know about that?
Well, you know, she chuckles when she hears about, you know, the feminist husband. I mean, I have a long way to go. I grew up in the 50s just like lots of other people, and you don't change like that. I think I have a daughter, so I really do appreciate the importance of not having narrowly defined roles. My daughter wants to have as many choices as her brothers do. Mm-hmm. And she certainly has more choices today than her mother did when she was 21. Happens to be my daughter's age. And I was standing there when all this was happening, and I had a show that featured Gloria Steinem and other people, so I think I was exposed to a lot more information than would be the guy who's trying to, you know, make both ends meet by working a long day at the office or in the cab of the truck. And for that reason, I think that some people think I might have more of a responsibility to at least be sensitive to things that were not of concern to us in the 50s. And I am. I try. But it's hard to change. There's still a part of me. I mean, it's hard to... There's a part of me that would love to have Marlo waiting every night, you know, in a peignoir with a...
You mean Marlo doesn't wait every night in a peignoir?
With a frosted beer mug.
There's not a mother in this entire room here who loves her child 20 years with nothing in between there, or who can't stand her child 20 years in between there. Now, I have met mothers who just, you know, I mean, they sob real tears, you know, when their 30-year-old leaves the house. They say, oh, you know, why does she have to leave mommy? I could iron her blouses. I could take care of her, and they love it. And then there are people like me. You know, my son went to a long scout meeting, and I sold his bed. So we're talking two different mothers here.
Our first guest this morning is truly amazing. He has a great disposition. He just loves everybody. Everybody seems to love him. He enjoys life, and if you pardon the expression, has a great belly laugh. All these attributes go into making the person called Kent Nicholson, but he likes to be called by his nickname. I'd like you to welcome the Guinness Book of World Records, the largest man alive, Fat Albert. What exactly do you weigh? You weigh around 900 pounds.
891, I say.
891.
Yes.
Are you continuing to gain weight? I mean, could you go on a diet and, say, in 6 months lose weight?
No, I stayed on a diet for 3 years and never lost weight. It's due to my pituitary gland.
Pituitary gland?
Mm-hmm.
What did you weigh when you were born?
22 pounds at birth, 6.5
pounds.
So you
started out big and never stopped?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What did you weigh when you were a year old?
105 pounds at 1 year old.
Oh, my goodness. Did you learn to creep before you walked? I mean, was it hard for you to walk?
No, it wasn't.
The beginning?
No.
How big was your How big were your parents?
Well, my father's about 195, and my mother about 140.
And did how soon after you were born did they, well, if you have a 22-pound baby, I guess you know what's happening. How did she have a 22-pound baby?
Very carefully.
There are certain dreams that are common dreams that we all have. Everybody dreams of running and running and running and getting absolutely nowhere.
Yeah.
I think we've all had that dream. But you'll notice in your real life you say the same thing. I'm always moving and I'm not getting anywhere. And that's what this is, a frustration dream.
Oh, yeah.
The same thing goes with falling. Usually when you're afraid of something that you've done is not going to work out, or if you're looking for a job and you think you're not going to get it, you dream that you're falling. And everybody dreams they're falling, and they're always afraid of hitting the bottom, because they say if you hit the bottom, you're supposed to die. How would they know? No one's ever woke up when they hit the bottom, would they? To tell us about it.
You're right. I never thought of it that way.
Exactly.
No, but who wants to hit bottom? Maybe.
Well, they do. But what you'll do is you wake up suddenly. This dream is part of two type of dreams. Either you're frustrated, or the fact that perhaps you are very, very heavily tired and you're going to sleep. And as you go right into a heavy, heavy sleep, you dream you're falling and falling. And this is this fear of going to the unknown. It's always dark down there, you know.
Miss Nighthawk.
Yes.
You can tell me. This is fakery, right?
MSP? Male chauvinist pig.
No, it's just, you're not really, you take your falls, nobody really gets hurt.
Come on. Ladies, would you like me to see me do something to this gentleman?
Hey, it's all an act. It's an act, okay.
Before I do... ladies and gentlemen, before I do this, let me just know, I am known as one of the bad guys on the team. Can I take your shoes off?
Shoes off?
Yes. I'll even help him. I bet this is the first time this has ever happened to him. The dog probably takes them away from him. Okay, gentlemen, ladies.
No, it's just going to be,
I guess she showed me, huh? It was real, and it did hurt.
There's much more to come, including some of our favorite celebrity guests. Betty White tells us what she really thinks of the Golden Girls.
And up next, we take the show on the road to Port Charles and Pine Valley, some of your most loved soap opera towns. We'll be right back. Welcome back. If you're just joining us, we're taking a trip back in time with our look at the best of Kelly and Company. You know, over the many years we were on air together, we must have talked to hundreds of different people.
A lot
people,
of them. Mm-hmm.
From presidents to pastors, actors, singers, musicians, even psychics.
And some of my favorite episodes were when we took the show to places like SeaWorld, and hundreds of Detroiters followed us there. It was great. SeaWorld was a lot of fun, but nothing compares to our trip to Pine Valley and Port Charles, where we rubbed elbows with America's favorite daytime diva, Erica Kane, and one of the soap world's most popular leading men, Robert Scorpio.
So, sit back and enjoy a guided tour through Pine Valley.
New York, the cultural and entertainment center of the world, home of Broadway, Bloomingdale's, and Pine Valley. Its city limits are within one ABC building in the heart of Manhattan.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Jack Kelly, Marilyn Turner. We're from Detroit, and we're here to do some work in All My Children.
Oh, yes. They're expecting you in the rehearsal hall.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Listen, anybody can throw a baton up in the air and catch it. Big deal doesn't mean she's going to win the contest.
And now you rewind.
It's 7:30 a.m., and Liza's already at it. And soon, 15 other All My Children actors will be, too. The cast is given scripts a few days in advance. But this walkthrough is the first time the director says when, where, and how those lines should be spoken.
No, but I'm not sure if Jenny Gardner is going to lose.
Our scene is just one of 23 this particular day. After all of our studying, it's finally time to have a few words with Erica. Marilyn and I are playing Tony and Gloria Plum, a husband-wife morning talk show team. Sounds familiar. We're interviewing Erica and her boss, Kent, in town to judge a beauty contest.
The director listens carefully to our delivery and will make suggestions later. What a thrill carrying on a conversation with the woman fans most love to hate. But what does Susan Lucci really think about Erica? John found out.
But from my point of view, I think she's fun and a go-getter and a cat. She's a survivor.
Mm-hmm. Always lands on the 4 feet.
Yeah, always lands on the 4 feet. And he's got at least 7 lives, or 9, how many they have. And she's charming. She's very impatient to have a terrific life and have it right now. She'd walk over dead bodies to get there. She's not too nice, but I don't think of her as a bitch when I'm playing her.
I've read that basically you're a shy person. How do you handle that in relation to the job you have now?
Being shy, it's not to say that a lot of those things that I do as Erica are not inside my head or within the realm of what I feel. It's just that I don't always express them. I tend to not express in my working life. I mean, at home, I express it all. But, you know, just if I'm meeting someone, people say to me sometimes when they meet me, you're not like Erica. Well, I want to say to them, and I don't, but I want to say to them, well, we've just met. Should I be in gold lame at 12 noon on the street, and you didn't do anything to me? Should I kick you in the shins anyhow? You know, I don't know what people expect to see.
Our next stop, Port Charles.
Millions of dedicated daytime viewers turn off their own problems and tune in to General Hospital each day. This soap has a tremendous and loyal following. Yet, General Hospital is no newcomer to the daytime scene. It celebrated its 21st anniversary on April the 1st of last year, making it the longest-running daytime drama to be produced on the West Coast.
Our day began at 8:30 a.m. as we headed out of the Century Plaza Hotel to famed Port Charles, Lot 74 at the Sunset Gower Studios in Hollywood. Producer Gloria Monty invited John and I out to L.A. to do a scene with daytime's hottest characters.
Marilyn and I studied our lines over and over again, even on the way to the studio.
Is that all there is to it?
That's all there is to your part, darling.
It's all over, all right?
That's right.
I went through all that... 1,500 miles just to do this?
Oh, dear, well, they know talent when they see it.
Detroit talk show host doing General Hospital?
Guess we'll have to show them how it's done.
First, it's straight over to our dressing rooms, and we're called for makeup. Makeup artist PK has some interesting tips on looking like you're straight from Port Charles.
Say if somebody's been in jail for 6 months and they come out and they look like they've been on the Riviera.
Well, then that's your job, to make them look like they've been in jail.
Yes.
Then it's straight over to the hairdressing department. And one look at me had them grabbing for rollers. They love John. He had that built-in distinguished look. A short comb, and he was ready.
Then we're off to wardrobe.
I like it.
We were anxious to see just what we would be wearing.
I have a good body. Why, Dolores?
I do like a Filipino.
I had a chance to wonder which daring ladies have the pleasure to wear some pretty sexy outfits.
There's got to be a story behind this.
Tell me. Well, this, Jackie Zeman wore this one time in one of her bed scenes.
A lot of bedroom scenes.
Oh, yes.
In general.
I wonder what John would think if they chose this for me to wear.
Well, our makeup is done, our outfits are chosen. We headed up to the set for our first rehearsal.
Tristan Rogers, who plays Robert Scorpio, and Emma Sams, who plays Holly, his wife, look so different with street clothes and no makeup.
And now for our big scene.
Good at remembering faces. I'm glad to hear that.
But Dad, I wouldn't have recognized my own mother.
Not even your own mother?
Oh, the place was jumping. You see, a lot of flights to Miami were canceled because of a storm at the Miami airport. So flight 88 was jammed with people who were coming here instead. People were everywhere looking for each other, waiting for somebody.
Are you leading up to telling us you don't recognize this man?
People trying to rent cars? No, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
He said people were trying to rent cars.
I meant Stella.
She looks very efficient.
And cute.
All we need is efficient. Oh. May I help you? Yes.
Well, I certainly hope you can. My name is Robert Scorpio.
Police Commissioner for Port Charles, New York.
And I'm Holly Scorpio, his sister.
What kind of car would you like, and what's your destination?
Well, actually, we We don't want to rent a car. What we'd like to know is if this man perhaps rented a car on the morning of January 15th. His name is D.L. Brock.
Mr. Brock had a slight New York City accent and a very short fuse.
What?
Well, he could lose his temper with very little provocation.
Oh, I remember him. He snarled at me when I didn't have the make of car he preferred.
That's our boy.
He was really mean. Oh, gosh, I hope he's not a friend of yours.
No, he wasn't. Isn't.
Wasn't.
He's dead.
Oh, police commissioner.
Yeah, I'm looking into it.
Oh, I see.
What we'd like to know is if Mr. Brock met someone here and what his destination was.
I don't think he met anyone, but I can get the other information for you on the computer. It won't take but a few minutes.
Oh. Is there a place we need to get some coffee?
Yeah, there's a coffee machine right over there in the corner.
Machine?
Well, it's no worse than the coffee in the cafeteria. You know, I do remember one thing.
Yeah?
He wanted a road map that would show him the shortest route to Miami.
Miami?
This isn't going to help Bobby at all.
Let's get that coffee. Thank you.
Oh, John flubbed a couple of times. Of course, I was perfect. Sure was exciting to see how professional everyone is. And yet, the long hours don't dampen anyone's sense of humor. What was that attendant saying to Scorpio?
What kind of information were Scorpio and Holly trying to get out of that rental car agent?
We'll never tell.
That was such a great trip.
Oh, it was just wonderful.
If I remember correctly, Marilyn, you were a little bit starstruck.
Actually, I was. I loved being in Hollywood and seeing all the movie stars and walking to our hotel. Remember that? And we had a parade of Hollywood's best come to us right here in Detroit, coming up with some of their favorite celebrity guests.
Today's program is brought to you in part by Medicare Solutions, powered by HAP.
I am writing today to say thank you for my HAP Medicare plan and for giving me someone who understands Medicare and knows my name. Thank you for giving me a plan that covers my vision and dental needs and even helps with my gym membership. I may be just one customer, but I feel like I'm your only one.
I'm Doris Bisco for HAP. We get letters like this all the time, and they speak for themselves. A recent study showed that people who have HAP love HAP. That's because HAP offers several products that are easy to use and affordable for you. And we've added exciting new benefits this year. Call today to speak directly to a HAP Medicare expert. We'll take time to answer any questions you may have about Medicare options. We'll even send you a free educational booklet that explains Medicare. Call now to get more from your Medicare coverage with Medicare Solutions, powered by HAP.
It's Magic's Open Opportunity event, and the opportunity is all yours. Get new windows from Magic now, and we'll pay your heating and cooling bills for the next 6 months. The choice is obvious. Make it magic.
Today we're celebrating 60 years of Channel 7 history, and we were fortunate to be part of it. And, you know, Kelly and Company was really cutting edge at that time, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. I hate to brag, but we did pave the way for a lot of other shows that came after us. We held a wedding every year. Yep. We went on location. And, of course, we did talk to all the top celebrities of the day. Here's just a few.
Our first guest today is indeed one of television's most glamorous women. From commercials to the sexy and successful Charlie's Angels to roles as Jackie Kennedy and Sally Fairfax, Jacqueline Smith has proven that she is not only a beautiful woman, but a very talented one as well. Please welcome the fabulous Jacqueline Smith to Kelly and Company. Charlie's Angels was very successful. When you look back at it now, is it something you would have done or not have done?
Would have done.
When you look back now.
Yeah, when I look back now, I'm very thankful for it.
It opened a lot of doors for me. It is, within the industry, an image I'm fighting to break down or to form a new image, because they do see you in glamour-oriented roles. Mm-hmm. But each thing I've done is a step in the right direction, and I keep hoping, well, they'll see me in another light. But as far as the general public, they couldn't be more receptive, and they couldn't be more accepting in seeing you in different roles. I think it's the industry. And you do get typed as an empty-headed, Barbie doll. But it really did good things, and it was an education, and to learn to work that fast. I mean, a show, it took 7 days to do one show, but I mean, we worked from
many
five,
hours.
Yeah, many, 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 many hours, which was hard, and a great discipline.
I was wondering, with all these sensuous scenes you do with all these actresses, have you ever found yourself really emotionally involved with one of them, or a few, or a lot of them?
Which is that?
Now, what do you really want to know? Whether
do you stay up all night?
Was I involved with some of them, a few, or a lot of them?
Well, when you go home, do you know, it's on your mind?
Let me disillusion you. When you're making love scenes in a movie, it's very difficult because you have so many factors to consider. You see, when we play a role, sometimes someone will say, oh, Kirk, my guy, I saw Lust for Life. My, you were just lost in that part. I say, no, you were lost. I was not lost. I had to have the discipline of creating an illusion for you to be lost. If I were lost in Lust for Life, I might have cut off my ear. I have to pretend that I do it. The same way in a love scene. You see, sometimes you have to place the woman in the right angle so the light hits her face correctly. So it is difficult. It is difficult to get very sexy in a love scene, but occasionally you do work with a girl, and then I find, instead of being Spartacus, a little bit of Kirk Douglas comes through.
Lynn Anderson came out with a song called
Thank
Rose
you.
Garden. Mm-hmm. And I was so impressed that she could have a huge hit. Yeah. And not have a southern accent. And I said, you know what, I love country music, I'd really love to sing country music. And it was from that song, and my mother was always very supportive of the things that we wanted to mm-hmm. do and achieve, mm-hmm. and none of my mm-hmm. family had gone into country music. And I like that, because I didn't feel the need to follow them or anything else. It was my style of music and something that I really loved. And I've always loved it. It's amazing, though, how country music has grown, especially in the last, five, 6 years.
But you liked it at a really young age.
I loved country before everybody else liked country.
You know? Right, ahead of your time.
I got up so early today. Blue socks.
You got blue socks. Where's
Check
your purple socks? Where's your purple socks?
I grew up, Marilyn.
You did used to wear purple socks all the time.
I used to. I don't believe I did that.
How long did that go on?
7 years, every day for 7 years.
Didn't you run out of purple socks? I mean, where did you find
them?
No,
I had to special order them from Burlington Industries out of New York. 300 pair.
Did you went through 300 pair of socks?
That's right. You know what made me give it up? I mean, it's funny, kind of embarrassing, but my wife, when we first got married, she didn't know how to wash clothes all that well, and so she put my purple socks with all my underwear, pink underwear.
Oh.
Listen, you're 15 years old now, don't you think about dating and guys? What do you do?
Well,
I understand your mother's over there, and she's listening, and she.
No, my mom's great about it. I date every once in a while and stuff, but...
Alone?
Yeah.
Speaking as the father of daughters, are you chaperoned?
No. My parents trust me.
That has nothing to do with it. We're talking California, Los Angeles, show business, crazy people here.
No, it's not like I date actors.
Oh.
It's nice to be in Detroit. You haven't been here for a little while, have you?
No, not since 83, as a matter of fact.
Not since 83?
Not since I was 83.
Oh.
Huh?
I love it.
You are absolutely a skit. You really are. You have the greatest sense of humor.
Oh, no, not really.
Not really? You're nasty in the morning when you get up?
No, bad not mood? Really. Just kind of bland. Is bland the word you're groping for?
Well, every time I've called you, it's been early in the morning because it's like 11 o'clock here and it's like 8 o'clock there. And I always hate to call you at that time because I think you're in bed, but you're always sitting there with your feet on Dinah.
That's right.
And Dinah's a dog.
I have a golden retriever set for 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, we know about that, boy. Their alarm goes off no matter what,
no
right?
matter what.
What do you think about the role you play as Rose in the Golden? How would you describe Rose?
Oh, I love Rose. I just love her. She, bless her heart, she's not dumb. Everybody thinks of her, you know. She is naive to the point of she suffers from terminal naivete. But she just takes everything literally. Mm-hmm. I mean, she takes every word for its surface meaning. If you said I could eat a horse, she'd call the SPCA. You know, she could take it.
Cruelty.
But it's that innocence that allows her to live with those other three ladies.
Yeah. We sure had a lot of fun on those shows, but we really weren't afraid to tackle some tough issues as well.
That's right. We were talking about hot topics long before The View. And when we come back, we'll introduce you to some of our more controversial guests. And later, Detroit's own Lily Tomlin comes home for a visit. We'll be right back.
Most people remember all the fun that we had on Kelly and Company, but we didn't shy away from controversy.
If it was in the news, we were talking about it. We took on everything from abuse to addiction, politics to promiscuity. Here are some of our more controversial subjects.
I'd like to know if your political views has affected your career in a positive or negative way.
It has affected my life. It has affected my life in a very positive way. I feel that it helped the cancellation of Lou Grant, but the feeling I engendered in myself, it was well worth it. I only have this to say. I will go on working. Everybody else on this show is working on other projects. To me, I regard the cancellation of Lou Grant in two ways. One, the intimidation of other performers in speaking out what they believe in, number one. And number two is that we did a great job, the producers did, in creating a very real format representing journalism. In that format, we were able to deal with issues that other formats can't deal with, issues that affect our lives and our deaths and our everyday being. With the cancellation of that show, that format and those issues are no longer on the air. So it's the public that's the loser.
Because President Reagan's basic philosophy does not put diplomacy and negotiation as a top priority. He's been much more inclined to use the tremendous military power of our country as the best avenue to encourage other people to do what we want them to do. This was a case when he injected U.S. Marines into Lebanon, and it's presently the case in Central America, where instead of going toward the negotiating table, as the other democracies want to, and as some of the adversaries want to, we've been the obstacle to negotiation. And we believe that a large number of American troops or threat of American military force being used is the best approach. So I would say during the last 4 years, we've made no progress in the Middle East.
How do you shrug off the criticism, or do you shrug it off?
Well, at first, you know, I had a very thin skin like most people, and the first time I saw my name in print associated with words such as mean and crude and rude, I went home and I thought, my goodness, I've failed. And the next day someone called me and said, congratulations. I said, why? I said, well, they've described you perfectly. So I've toughened up since then. You know, I don't like the criticism, but I'd love to be loved by everyone, but that's not the real world. And the job that I do, I think, is one in which people who love Ronald Reagan don't want to hear any criticism or any suggestion that he's done anything wrong. I wouldn't if I had a hero who was president of the United States, and they then want to take it out on me. It's okay.
Do you get a lot of mail?
Yeah, I do. Some people write me, say they like my work, and they like the way reporters are trying to hold presidents' feet to the fire, but some people write. The worst letter I got wasn't really the meanest letter. It was the address. It was addressed, and I say in my book, to Sandinista Sam, Washington, D.C. I guess I didn't mind that so much as the fact that the postmaster delivered it unerringly to me.
He found you.
To say lesbian nuns apparently shocks people because they have already categorized lesbians as being on one pole and nuns as being on the opposite pole. To put the two together seems unthinkable in a polarized society. And we do live in a polarized culture which polarizes men against women, blacks against whites, rich against poor, that sort of thing. I think ultimately what we're saying in the book is that there are lesbian nuns, and what it means is that women can be both sexual and spiritual, intellectual, political, all at the same time.
The only way of being more secure, I don't ever say safe sex, there's no such thing, we don't know what it is, but safer sex. Now, I have been talking about contraceptives in order to prevent unwanted pregnancies. And there, I must say, I'm happy because we do see a trend that maybe the number of unwanted pregnancies is receding. It's not just because of me. Mm-hmm. It's because of you. You know why? Look at the eyes. I tell you why, because of you. I'm not talking about your sex life. It's because of you inviting people like me talking about contraceptives.
Yes.
Now, it's not enough. What we need to do, we need to advertise condoms on television. We need to have the soap operas. Every time they show two people in bed, we need a box of condoms right next to that bed. Right next to that bed.
Some of those shows got a little wild. That's nothing compared to what's coming up next.
Coming up, we're off to the circus, and then some of our wildest moments on the show. Stay with us. Welcome back to the best of Kelly and Company. It seems the sky was the limit on our show, you know? Our producers were game for just about anything we could dream up.
We did all sorts of skits. We learned the latest dance steps.
Oh, yeah.
We tried out new workout routines, she did. And sometimes it was real circus, even in the studio. Take a look.
Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, our guest ringmasters, John Kelly and Marilyn Turner, with the greatest show on earth.
Well, I understand that you, my dear, look at the camera while I tell everybody this.
I know this.
Have volunteered to participate in a particular elephantine endeavor. Is that right, Jim?
Elephantine endeavor.
Yes. Okay, well, now I'm just going to get out of the way.
Yes, John's going to get out of the way.
Turn you over to Axel and the
all
family.
All right,
Dan,
I'm in your hands. Lay right in the center.
A doormat,
yeah. Tarter is extremely so there really isn't a lot of danger.
See? Can you tap this?
Lay down. Keep her foot close.
I just what? If her foot looks close, I just tap it.
This is called a walkover. A walkover. What Tarter is going to do is show us and the world how adept she is and how she knows exactly where Marilyn is at all times. You notice that she brings her back foot as close as she possibly can to Marilyn and then steps completely over.
Very careful. Oh, that's my girl! We're going to look at, statistically, the most dangerous of our poisonous snakes found in the United States. It is the Western Diamondback Rattlesnake, and I'm going to put the snake here on the table. And as I explained to some of the ladies before the program, this snake may not stay on the table.
Are you fast, Bob? If you ain't, I am. Open the door, guys, in case I want to split.
Mad.
Okay, now, let's see what happens.
Let me tell you that while Bob is doing that, Bob has been bitten 19 times up until today.
Now, the reason that I'm moving my hand is to keep the snake's attention. I'd rather it stay on the table. This is a Western Diamondback Rattlesnake, and anyone bitten by one 4 feet or longer, they're in grave danger because
he's looking at me.
The snake is fully capable The snake is fully capable of injecting a lethal quantity of venom.
You are never, ever, ever too old to exercise. Believe me, you can increase your strength, you can increase your endurance, your flexibility. I'm not saying I can take a 90-year-old woman and make her look like a 16-year-old kid, but she'll be the sexiest looking 90-year-old woman you've ever seen. Look, all of you out there, how many of you would like to increase your energy 20%? Let me see your hand. You can do it. Your flexibility, your endurance, all these things. But you have to do something about it. You can't sit on your great big fat overstuffed behind and think about what I used to. You've got to do something.
How about the walnut walk?
Oh, yeah, one of the...
Let's everybody stand up. Will you do this with us? Everybody stand up. Come on.
Now, you have a walnut right here between
walk.
Your teeth.
Okay.
But you got a walnut here, right?
Okay, got it.
Now squeeze it.
Squeeze the walnut between your seat.
This is where the problem comes. All you gals, you know, this hangs and sags and roots. You're fighting gravity. Crack that walnut. Put your hand in your seat. Feel it. Now squeeze. You feel how tight that is? You never knew it was that tight, did you?
I'll show you what I do when I come here to the Motor City. Mm. Every time I drive, you know, during rush hour especially, I sit there and I put these on. And it works. Nobody cuts me off. No one stops me. I drive wherever I want. I park wherever I want. I pick up hitchhikers. They don't even want to get in. See hitchhikers? Get in. They're going, no thanks, we have a bus pass. I brought a pair for you.
Oh, a pair for me?
A pair for you.
My own?
Your own pair? Here, here you go.
Oh, let's see. Crazy cop. Wait, should I put them on?
Put them on, right?
Okay, all right, wait a minute here. Crazy comic eyes.
Those are good. I know people of your celebrity here. People are stopping me all the time, going, "Hey, there's John Kelly. Let's stop him." Just go. No, you don't.
Okay, here I go. Let's see.
Open them up wide, and then put them in and close your eyes on them. There you go.
That's right. I drove all the way from Miami. Didn't miss a light. Yeah. I love this. Hello, my name is Bill Bonds. Here's the damn news.
See, it goes like this. He says, it's...
Okay, now...
It's very easy. Because people all over Detroit used to do this.
Yeah.
It was really, that was a ritual, you know? Okay. Okay. First, back and forth, just like this. Do this, see? That's it. Hey, and then you can go to the side, couple over this way.
Okay.
Yeah, that's it. Yes, and then you go.
That's hard.
No, try it. Try it. That's it. That's it.
Enough of that. Go sit down.
Great. 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 Great.
Happy birthday.
Richard Simmons was always a lot of fun. He was a good friend of the show and actually hosted for us when we were away.
He always made us laugh. Mm-hmm. And speaking of laughs, when we return, some of our funniest guests ever. Stay tuned.
Continuing our look back at the best of Kelly and Company. You know, John, we really had a huge group of local viewers, didn't we?
Yeah, you're right.
Loyal
people. We even had groupies, remember? There were some audience members that came back every day, day after day. Partly, I think, because we always had so much fun. Here's some more examples.
Yes. What do you think about the addition to the royal family?
I don't give a damn.
The baby looks like her, because the afterbirth is going to look like him.
He's walking up the street, and he sees a preacher, and he says, "Pardon me, sir, is you a preacher?" He says, "Yes, I am." He said, "Would you answer me a question?" He says, "If I can, what is it?" He says, "Is it true we came from dust?"
He says, yes. Yes, we came from dust. And when we pass on, does we go back to dust again? He said, we came from dust and we go back to dust. Why do you ask? He said, would you mind coming up to our house and look under the bed, because somebody's either coming or going.
George, you were a real hellraiser. You were. You are a real hellraiser.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I shouldn't start a story, should I?
No. What?
Poor Barbara. Susie and Barbara and I use this in 9 to 5, but with the three of us were sleeping over at Barbara's house, see, and Barbara had this older brother, Joey, and Joey had a car, and because we craved a car. I mean, we lusted for a car. And so we get up in the middle of the night, and we steal his keys off his dresser, you know, and we go down, and we decide we're going to try to go to the drive-in, like in the middle of the night, and of course, we wreck the car before we get away from the curb. I mean, just break the headlights out, the taillights, broke the fenders.
You that was driving.
And the car was a mess, you know, and then so we had to go back and sneak and put the keys back on the dresser and go back to bed. So the next morning, when everybody comes down to the kitchen, you know, they say, was anybody up last night, like, doing anything, you know, like that? And we said, what do you mean? What, you know, I don't know what you're talking about. So if you look at 9 to 5, when the cop stops me in the car, I use the same, I just try to live that same moment, you know, and he said.
You know, so many Detroiters, like Lily Tomlin, have gone on to make it really big in Hollywood.
It is true, and we were privileged to have most of those people on our show one time or another. It's been a great ride.
Now, when we come back, more Best of Kelly and Company memories and an update on what's been happening with us since the show ended. Stay with us.
Fun looking back on those old Kelly
been.
Company days. Say yes.
Oh, yes, it is.
Okay. Actually, though, the show really ended over 10 years ago. And for that entire time, Marilyn, you did a great job.
Oh, thank you, John.
Marilyn did a great job.
You did a great job. Done it without you.
Yeah, you like that. Try it.
Now, you know, a lot of people ask us what we've been up to since the show ended in 1995. Well, we spend half our time here in Michigan and half our time in Florida. And we rescue animals down there. We're raising horses.
Got some horses.
We're having a good time.
We'd like to thank all of you for being with us for the entire time of Kelly and Company. It was a long time ago, and it was a good time. Thanks for being part of your lives. We were thrilled to be a part of Channel 7's 60th anniversary.
But say goodbye now with one more look back at the Best of Kelly and Company. And for all of us here at Channel 7, thanks so much for watching. Bye-bye.
The thing is, last time I was here, I flirted with your husband.
That's
because
right.
I didn't know.
That's right.
I didn't know they were married. Nobody told me.
I'm pretty hot stuff. What do you treat me like, top liver?
I always cry. Why do people cry at weddings?
Wait. I know why. I haven't kissed a bride yet.
Oh, thank you.
Congratulations. Chandler?
I kissed
Chandler,
you.
Wait.
He's in the mood. He's rolling.
Sometimes he doesn't have that much interest. It comes and goes sometimes. So, Marilyn, you're going to have to get him working a little bit on that. She's going to have to rev you up a little.
God knows I try.
I don't work cheap.
Okay, I just want you to know that you are the best thing that ever has happened to me in my life. I kid you on the air about cooking. I kid you on the air about a lot of things. And I tease you in private, too. Once in a while, I make you angry, which I never want to do. I just think you are a marvelous person. And I'm glad that this marvelous person turned out to be a woman. Otherwise, you know what I'm saying? And I... And I'm particularly glad that the woman decided she'd spend time with me, and I intend to make it for the rest of my life.
Well, that woman's very happy that she decided to spend time with you. She's a very lucky woman.
Yeah, she is. Thank you, dog. Thank you, gang.